Hello, and welcome back for this third edition of Learn to Play the Beatles to a T. It's great to have you back. Throughout the process of creating this DVD, I've made an effort to improve upon the user-friendly aspects of the instruction, much of which simply stems out of necessity, as well as our acknowledgement of all the insightful feedback we receive from folks like you. There's so much to discuss that I'll delve right into the topic at hand. I'd first like to mention that all electric guitar parts, with the exception of one song, which I'll discuss when we reach it, have been recorded by running direct into a Vox Valvetronics tone lab. This was done more so out of necessity than anything else. The tonal versatility and ease of use of the tone lab provided the perfect solution for me to cover such a vast array of what would otherwise be rather challenging tonal and production demands. To that end, I'd like to add that there's certainly nothing like the real thing in regards to the amplifiers. For the purposes of this instruction, however, the tone lab proved to be an invaluable tool. I'd like to also discuss the type of strings I used on all the electric guitars you'll be seeing and hearing throughout this presentation. Now, as with most things, preferences on string choice boils down to the personal satisfaction one gets out of a particular brand, and results tend to vary from player to player. It's always best, if you're not sure, to experiment with different types to see what strings work best for you. The strings I've found to work best for me in this arena of music are pyramids. I've been really happy with the feel and tone I get from them. Most of the guitars you'll see in this video are equipped with, specifically, Pyramid Gold 10s or 11s, which are flat-wound strings as opposed to the more common round-wounds. Now for a couple of changes that I've implemented in this DVD that will give you, the viewer, some better options for learning. The manner in which the audio in this DVD has been mixed allows you to pan left or right to hear a particular guitar part with a substantial degree of separation from the other. This will enable you to hear things that you may otherwise miss. This feature works best when there are only two guitar parts being played. In the case of a third guitar, the audio for that can be heard through both speakers. So have some fun messing around with that. Another thing we've done to make the learning process easier is we've added more chapter markers. You can now navigate to each segment within a song lesson. This brings me to the slowed segments, which have also undergone a change. You will first view the real-time version of how the song should ultimately sound, then immediately following will be the slowed segments. These individual slowed segments will appear in the same numerical order as indicated in the real-time segments. Some songs may have several guitar segments that require slowing, while others will have less. We'll use the two guitar segments in I Should Have Known Better as an example. The first guitar segment to be shown slowly after the real-time version is indicated by the number one, which happens to be the solo in this case. We'll then jump forward to that same segment shown slowly. The green dots on the fretboard signify where your finger or fingers need to be. In instances where a picking pattern of any kind takes place, you'll see orange dots to the left of the neck. These indicate precisely which string to pick when multiple strings are being fretted. The video portion on the upper half of the screen should be studied to determine exact finger placement. Now back to the real-time version, where you'll notice the number two on the screen indicating that what we're observing at this moment will be the second segment to be shown using the illustration of the guitar neck. These are actually just chords that occur during the middle eight, which I chose to show the finger placement for on the fretboard as seen here. And for more information on that Beatles suit you just saw, check out the Beatles suits link on the homepage of this DVD. The first song we'll get rolling on was recorded on February 11th, 1963, as part of a marathon session that produced most of the songs that appeared on the Beatles' first LP, Please Please Me. Only four songs that appear on the album weren't recorded on this day, but were already released as singles in their respective B-sides. These songs were Love Me Do with P.S. I Love You, and Please Please Me with its B-side, Ask Me Why. The rest of the album was recorded on this day, an astonishing musical feat by any standards. Twist and Shout was the last song to be recorded at this session that lasted well into the evening. After an entire day of performing song after song while at the same time nursing a cold, John couldn't possibly have too many shots at laying this screamer down, and everyone knew it. The one and only take, of course, wound up being the historic performance that we all know and love. I chose to present this song using the two guitars used to perform the song live. I used a Rickenbacker 325 C58 that's been altered cosmetically to resemble Lennon's first Rick. For the George part, I used the Gretsch Country Classic 2, which is a reissue of the Country Gentleman. This song was recorded prior to George acquiring this guitar, though, and since the recording doesn't sound at all like the Duo Jet, which he used on this album, it's my opinion that the guitars used to record this song were both Gibson J160Es plugged in. For many years, when I listened to this song, I assumed they turned down the rhythm guitar during the solo, since it appears to just drop out. What's really happening is John and George are both partaking in the lead work. Each guitar doesn't actually play an individual note line, but instead they each play multiple notes at a time, though their approach is slightly different from the other. Pay attention to the Gretsch at the end during the ascending note climb. Notice that only single notes are being played during this climb instead of the entire chord. The next few songs coming up are songs that appeared on the only Beatles album where every song was composed by Lennon-McCartney, A Hard Day's Night. And we'll begin it with I Should Have Known Better. Here's a song that works great for an intermediate guitarist. There are no difficult rhythm guitar chords, only brilliantly placed simple ones. It's just a nice example of Lennon's fantastic rhythm genius, which brings me to those strange bell-like overtones that can be heard most prominently during the intro. I used to get the mental picture of someone hitting an anvil with a hammer, but that ringing metal-to-metal sounding tone comes not from an anvil, but the J160E. You'll hear the sound in several Beatles songs, including a few on this DVD. Some things you can do to help achieve this sound is, one, use phosphor bronze strings. I use 11-gauge phosphor bronze. I've found that these strings can help to achieve that chimey ring sound, which, by the way, appears to emanate solely from the G string. Interestingly, when playing D and G chords specifically. Another thing you can do to help get that string to chirp is to use a hard pick, strumming in between the sound hole and the bridge. Let's see if you can pick it out. Now onto the album's title track, A Hard Day's Night. There's much to be said about this one, so we'll begin by recapping the famous hotly debated intro chord. The guitar chords are quite simple. Both play an F with a G on top. It's that piano chord and the way it's mixed in that adds so much depth and mystery to the chord. The piano provides the following notes in one simultaneous hit. The solo segment is an interesting story. It wasn't until I mulled over the highly detailed Recording the Beatles book that I really knew the specifics of this lead. The initial studio run-throughs of the song yielded no significant ideas for a constructive solo. It's likely that George Harrison was first introduced to the song on this day and simply didn't have the time to come up with anything suitable right then and there. It was then suggested by George Martin for Harrison to just play the rhythm chords during the segment and that they'd come up with a solo for it later. What they wound up doing once they got a proper backing track recorded is quite interesting. The typical record speed for the tape machines at Abbey Road was what was referred to as 15 IPS, meaning the tape traveled across the record heads at a rate of 15 inches per second. What they did when they recorded the solo was played along with the slowed rhythm track, running at only 7.5 IPS, which is precisely half speed and, interestingly, one octave lower. This conveniently allowed them to play along in the same key the backing was recorded in, which was G. Harrison began the phrase on the Rick 12 string down at the 3rd fret 6th string, as low as the riff could be played. Martin doubled the phrase on a piano, beginning down at the low G, more than 2 octaves below middle C. Once captured to tape, they rolled it back up to 15 IPS, and voila, there it was. During the lesson segment for the lead, the Rick 12 string and piano audio are separated, so you may isolate one from the other. You'll first see the original slow speed I recorded at, followed by the sped up segment. And yes, to make this work visually, I had to also speed up the video to match the sped up audio. So I'm not the bionic man, I just simply employed the video speed up function out of necessity. Another really cool thing that I learned analyzing this tune is that the outro riff is played differently than I always thought. Trick is, you need a 12 string to make it work. This outro is merely a picking phrase played out of the opening chord. Remember? That F with a G on top. And despite the way this riff sounds here on this DVD, I recorded the riff direct and clean with no reverb at all. What you're hearing is that unmistakable sustaining ring that is signature for Rickenbacker 12 strings. And remember, this song is full of G and D chords, so listen for all those clanky overtones from the acoustic.